This week on Maker Update, a phone that won't fit in your pants pocket, a railgun for grapes, parkerizing metal, and staying safe when you're on the trail. Hello and welcome back to the 400th episode of Maker Update. Whether you're new here or you've been along the ride for a while, this is the show where we keep you up to date on all the cool things that makers are making. I'm Tyler Weingartner and I hope you're all doing great. We've got an awesome show for you, so let's get going with the project of the week. If you've been with us on the Maker Update journey for a while now, you should know that we love big projects. And this jumbo-sized iPhone replica by DIY Perks is no exception. This project came about because the Mr. Who's the Boss YouTube channel recently surpassed Apple in subscriber numbers. There's no YouTube play button just for that, so Aaron had to create his own. Or rather, have Matt from DIY Perks create one for him. A giant-sized iPhone. There's so much to talk about with this ambitious build. To make the touchscreen, they began with a commercial 88-inch 8K OLED display, which isn't a touchscreen. To turn it into one, they needed to add a massive resistive touch panel sandwiched between layers of thin acrylic. To make sure none of the optical clarity is lost, he's using LOCA glue, or liquid optically clear adhesive. Of course, every step of this process is permanent. And the price of failure is a whole lot of money. No pressure. The frame for the phone is made from big pieces of aluminum channel, and that creates space for all of the internals of the phone. The control boards and the power supply for the display will rest in here, as well as the computer controlling the operating system. And that deserves a special mention. Because iOS is tightly under lock and key, Matt's team had to recreate the entire interface in a customizable version of Android that could run on a PC. Another key component of the iPhone is its camera system, and Matt isn't slouching here. He's using a pair of mirrorless cameras that can be triggered remotely through software and send images back to it. For the telephoto lens, he's using a 45-degree mirror so the telescoping lens can fit within the housing. All of this is hidden behind a cosmetic bezel that resembles the iconic iPhone camera array. The outer rim of the phone is made from machined aluminum panels. Since the thing is so heavy, he made side panels that attach magnetically, and when removed, they reveal mounting holes for carry handles. Not to say that this build is in any way practical, but it's surprising to see how much practicality was built into this project. I could keep going on and on about this one, but just check it out for yourself. It's pretty amazing. More projects. If we're gonna go big, what's bigger than a jumbo-sized iPhone? The backcountry. Courtesy of Instructables, I learned about this totally wireless hiking trail map server created by Wayman 91. This is a USB device that can be powered by any external battery, and it will serve up its own store of map data to your phone, which might otherwise be starved for data connections when you're on the trail. The project makes use of a Lilygo T-Dongle S3 module and a BZ181 GPS module. And it's all housed within a custom 3D printed enclosure. I'm guessing you won't want to use this as your sole point of security, but if you go out into the wilderness often, this seems like a good DIY project that gives you one more tool in your arsenal if you ever need to navigate yourself or be found. From Julius Makes, we have this creative analog lamp. The lighting element of this lamp is scavenged from an old desktop scanner. After a bit of reverse engineering, which he details in the video, he's turned it into a working lighting element. The surprise here is that as he gradually increases the power to the lighting element, it doesn't just get brighter, the lighting element also gets longer. It's a cool trick and a gorgeous lamp concept. And finally, from Tom Stanton, we have a video where he's trying to make an electromagnetic launcher for his remote control planes. This is sort of like a miniature railgun, It uses an array of electromagnets to accelerate something down a linear path. Instead of using a complex controller for the timing of the magnets, he's looking for a purely mechanical solution, one that only uses the motion of the sled to activate the next set of magnets. To do this, he's created a rail and a carriage. The carriage uses the same sort of brushes that you might find in a Scalextric's car, since they're flexible and replaceable. But just to make things cheaper, he eventually ended up using solder wick. He uses a spring-loaded trigger to force it down the path, and once it starts, it just keeps accelerating until it runs out of magnets. There's a lot of fun tests with this, but there's also a few successful launches of his lightweight RC plane. Maybe not the most practical launcher, but this looks really cool and it could have lots of other applications. Now for some tips and tools from Federico Tobon at Cuddle, we have this amazing video about how to do inlays with your laser cutter. On paper, this sounds like it should be fairly easy. The laser beam only removes a tiny bit of material, so it should work just fine, right? Well, no. It still removes enough material to make the fit fairly loose. What's more, the cut is somewhat conical in shape, so materials cut in the same pass won't fit together easily. This video introduces tools to help you measure your laser curve and help you determine the best fit for your inlay project. From Breaking Taps, we have a new finishing technique for metal, and this one seems like it's a lot easier than most of the ones you've heard of. This is called parkerizing. It forms a microscopic crust of crystals on the surface of the steel to protect it from oxidation. All you need to do is perform a good surface scuffing of the part, degrease it, and there's an optional pickling step, followed by suspending the parts in a hot bath of parkerizing solution. Maybe try this out if you're looking for more metal finishing solutions. And finally, bear with me here while I nerd out on some film visual effects stuff that I just can't let go of. This is an older video from the visual effects group Corridor Crew about how Disney created the keying effects used in the production of the Mary Poppins film. You're probably familiar with chroma keying, better known as green screen, but this film was created using what's called the sodium vapor process. And it's technically better than modern chroma keying because it can capture transparent materials. It works by having a background screen illuminated by a very narrow band of visible light. And because of that narrow band, dichroic filters can separate the light into two images. The foreground image of the actors and another image dictating which parts should be transparent and which parts should be opaque. Similar to a modern alpha channel. It's an incredible technique and even more impressive when you consider that it's 60 years old. For this week's DigiKey Spotlight, we've mentioned the Adafruit series The Great Search a number of times before, but I don't think I've ever seen one that's as practical as this one. In this episode, they're looking for a bundled 3-pack of AA-sized nickel metal hydride batteries, commonly found in older toys. This video will help you demystify all the terms so you can find an ideal replacement pack with the right voltage, the right capacity, and avoid any of the ones that have proprietary circuitry. All right, and that is going to do it for this week's show. A reminder, as always, you can get more info about every single one of these projects by following the link down in the description. While you're there, give us a thumbs up, leave us a comment, and hit subscribe so you can keep up with the show. Big thanks to DigiKey for making this show possible and you for watching. Take care. We'll see you soon.